Hi everyone, I'm Fraser Cain. I'm the publisher of Universe Today. I've been a space and astronomy news journalist for over 20 years. This is our Space Bites episode, where we collect together a lot of the breaking news this week in space and astronomy and video it at you. I also write a much longer email newsletter that goes in great detail to all of the big breaking news stories this week, but we understand some of you want to have a video version, and that's what this is. All right, let's get into the news. NASA loses and then finds its CAPSTONE mission. Last week, we talked about NASA's CAPSTONE mission. This is a CubeSat that is going to be flying to the moon. It's going to be following this lunar halo orbit, the same orbit that the Lunar Gateway mission is going to be following. This is the space station that's going to be orbiting near the moon. And so NASA is sending the CAPSTONE mission to test out the orbit and make sure that it fulfills all of the requirements that they have for future exploration of the moon. And shortly after launch by the Rocket Lab Electron rocket, NASA lost contact with the spacecraft on July 4th. And it was a little scary for a while there, but they regained contact on July 7th. And after some debugging, they were able to figure out what went wrong. Apparently, they sent some improperly formatted commands to the radio system that caused it to shut down. And then it, realizing that it wasn't in contact with Earth again, reset itself, cleared the system, and they were able to re-establish contact and figure out what happened. So at this point, they've got contact with the spacecraft again, and it's on track to reach the moon in November, where it's going to go into this lunar halo orbit. James Webb takes the deepest image of the universe ever. So just a few more days until we can see these incredible pictures. But we got another sneak preview. This time, an image was taken by the Canadian Space Agency's Fine Guidance Sensor. This is an instrument onboard James Webb that's used to help make sure that it's locked onto its targets. So they actually did a very long test with the Fine Guidance Sensor. They did 72 exposures with a total of 32 hours of exposure with James Webb. And what this produced is the deepest image ever taken of the universe. This wasn't planned. This wasn't like some science they were doing. This was just a test of the instrument. And normally these images aren't downloaded from James Webb. But in this case, because they're still in the testing phase, they had some additional bandwidth available. Engineers decided to download this image, and it's incredible. When you look at this image, you're seeing the familiar spikes coming from the hexagonal mirrors and the support structure. And you're also seeing all of these faint little fuzzy blobs. And those are all galaxies. It is galaxies as far as the eye can see. And these galaxies mostly have never been seen before because they're outside of the wavelength that any existing telescope can see. So again, this is another sneak preview. James Webb releases the furthest image taken so far. And of course, this record is only going to stand for about a week until we see the next images, which will be the next time we see the farthest images ever seen. We think we know where the first quasars came from. This is a really big news story. I would say this is probably one of the most exciting stories that I've seen this week, because it answers one of the most long-standing questions that astronomers have had. And that is, how did supermassive black holes get so big so quickly? When you look back into the early universe, even less than a billion years after the Big Bang, there are supermassive black holes. These can have millions, sometimes even billions of times the mass of the sun. And the question is, how did they get so big so early in the universe? The traditional idea is that you would start with large stars, they would detonate a supernova, form black holes, the black holes would merge, then those black holes would merge with other black holes, and so on and so forth, and you would build up these bigger and bigger, more massive black holes. But every calculation that astronomers did didn't end up with the size of the black holes that they're seeing across the universe. We know of 200 quasars, which are actively feeding supermassive black holes, that were present in the universe within a billion years of the Big Bang. So how did they get so big so quickly? The other idea is that they somehow formed in place directly in a single event. But the problem with that idea is that as you start to pull more and more gas and dust into one single location, the star starts to turn on, it starts to blow out these really powerful stellar winds that will then stop any future material from accumulating down onto the star. And so we see stars here today that are limited to about, say, about 100 times the mass of the sun. You can't get a bigger star because of those powerful stellar winds. So how could you get something bigger? And so astronomers have done supercomputer simulations looking at the kinds of cold gas streams that were present in the early universe. And what they found is that these cold gas streams can form supermassive stars inside of them. And they're able to overcome these stellar winds by having turbulence inside the gas cloud as it's moving along. And so instead of just stars with 100 times the mass of the sun, you can theoretically get stars that have 30,000 times the mass of the sun, 40,000 times the mass of the sun. These things live very short period of time, collapse directly into very massive black holes, and then these can go on and merge and get you those supermassive black holes that we see today. So obviously more evidence is necessary. This is the kind of work that James Webb is going to be able to help to see some of these early galaxies as they're coming together, which may already have their supermassive black holes, and help pin down how these first black holes formed. But it's a really exciting new development in this search and could finally get us close to the answer of where supermassive black holes came from. We've seen a helicopter on Mars. How about a plane? Now, we're all very familiar with NASA's Ingenuity helicopter, which has been flying many times on the surface of Mars, over 20 times at this point. And so we know that a relatively lightweight helicopter with a very large rotor that spins very fast is able to maintain flight for a minute at a time. But could you have some other kind of flying vehicle at Mars? And another possibility is a sailplane. Now, you might know them as a glider. These are able to fly here in the atmosphere on Earth. They're able to maintain their altitude using updrafts that are coming up from warmer areas along mountains and things like that. And so the question is, like, would this work on Mars? And engineers at the University of Arizona are working on some sailplane prototypes and have done the calculations that would show that actually these could fly on Mars. Now, Mars has 1% the atmospheric density of Earth, and so it seems really weird to think that a sailplane could fly on Mars. But the key is the speed. A helicopter flies because it's able to turn its rotor very fast, able to produce lift. A sailplane could fly at the very high altitude in Mars, where the wind speeds are incredibly fast, and so they would provide the lift. So either the sailplane could be deployed as it's entering the Mars atmosphere, and then it could fly for hours or days, or maybe it could land on the surface, it could deploy some large balloon that would carry it up to the altitude, and then it would release it, and it would be able to drift around. And it would be great because it would allow it to cover very large distances across the surface of Mars, be able to explore really interesting territory like mountain ranges where there could be some uplift going on. Right now, they're in the process of testing sailplanes here on Earth. You raise them to a very high altitude on Earth, and actually you can get the same kind of atmospheric density on Earth as you get on Mars. And so it's a great place to test this idea out. Good news, the solar system will be stable for 100 billion years. The Milky Way is a pretty dynamic place. Stars are moving around, they're getting closer and farther away from each other. And in fact, astronomers have calculated that one star called Gliese 710 is going to get within about 10,000 astronomical units of the sun in the next million years or so. Now, it's not going to cause any damage to the inner solar system, but it could disrupt the Oort cloud, send a lot more comets into the inner solar system. Maybe that's how we've gotten mass extinction events in the past, so watch out in a million years from now. But the question is, could stars get any closer, and could they get close enough to actually disrupt the inner solar system and maybe tear the solar system apart? And so astronomers have done calculations where they've examined how close on average stars get to each other within the Milky Way. And what they found is that a star passing so close to another star that it disrupts any kind of planetary system is about a 1 in a 1 billion year event. And so what that means is that we would have to wait, on average, about a billion years for a star to come close enough that it would tear the solar system apart. Now, I'm sure you're thinking, well, the sun isn't going to last 100 billion years. And you're right, the sun is only going to last about 5 billion years. And you might also be wondering, is there going to be more flyby events happening when the Milky Way and Andromeda merge? But no, actually, the distances between stars are so vast that when Andromeda and the Milky Way merge in about 5 billion years, no stars are likely to collide with each other. It'll be like two swarms of bees flying past each other. So if you've got any long-term plans, you know, estimate a next 100 billion years or so of safety. A star has been found moving almost 3% the speed of light. Speaking of supermassive black holes, at the heart of the Milky Way, of course, we have Sag A star, which is a supermassive black hole with about 4.1 million times the mass of the sun. And this was discovered, confirmed, by Dr. Andrea Ghez and her team back in the early 2000s by using infrared observatories to be able to peer through the gas and dust surrounding the core of the Milky Way, and they were able to see these stars that were moving around in comet-like orbits around some hidden center of mass. And they were able to then calculate the mass of this object, this completely invisible object, to be about 4.1 million times the mass of the sun. And so that's how they confirmed that we have this supermassive black hole. And Dr. Ghez won a Nobel Prize just a couple of years ago for this discovery in black holes. And so astronomers have now been tracking these stars over decades with incredible sensitivity, and they found one star that seems to be the one that on the closest orbit around the supermassive black hole. It orbits every 4 years, and at its closest point, it gets to about 100 astronomical units from the sun, which is a little farther than the distance of the sun to Pluto. And when it does, when at the closest point of this orbit, it's going about 8,000 kilometers per second, which translates to about almost 3% the speed of light, which is kind of incredible. If you like what we're doing, why don't you consider joining our Patreon? This is, of course, the way that you can directly support the work that we do to help pay for the video editing, audio editing, all of the writers on Universe Today, production team. Every bit really helps us out. Go to patreon.com/universetoday. And if you do, you'll be able to see behind the scenes, you'll get access to all of our videos with no ads, and you'll be able to get a version of the Universe Today website that has no ads. And I will do that for life. Even if you decide not to become a patron, you'll have ad-free access to Universe Today for life. So consider supporting the work we do. Join our Patreon. Speaking of exclusive information, I did interviews with two team members on Universe Today. Talked to Matt Williams, who is an accomplished science fiction writer and focuses on a lot of our space flight stories. And then I also talked to Alan Boyle, who is a legend in the space journalism community. He has been a space journalist for over 20 years, a journalist for 40 years. One of my heroes and mentors, and I think you'll find it really fascinating to hear his career in space journalism, the rocket launches he's had a chance to see, and his advice for how to become a writer and a journalist. Those interviews are available on our Patreon feed. They're publicly available, but you're going to want to click the links in the feed below. The Psyche mission is getting delayed. We got bad news that NASA's Psyche mission, which is going to be traveling to asteroid Psyche, I know, kind of confusing, has been delayed. The reason is because the mission has a very short launch window. They've got to be able to fly between August and October because they're going to be using a flyby of Mars to be able to reach asteroid Psyche by 2026. And so that October 11th date is a hard timeline they've got to hit. And the problem is that they're working on the software testing and they realize that they're not going to have it ready in time for that October 11th launch. So that means they're going to have to use another launch window either in 2023 or 2024. And the downside is that means that the mission won't reach Psyche by 2029 or 2030, still using that Mars flyby. Super Heavy and Starship with 39 Raptor V2 engines. SpaceX shared a picture this week showing the Super Heavy booster with 33 Raptor V2 engines and the Starship with 6 V2 Raptor engines, bringing you a total of 39 Raptors. All of the Raptors on the Super Heavy are optimized for sea level, and 3 on Starship are optimized for sea level, and 3 are for vacuum. So the plan is that the Super Heavy and Starship will launch as a stack. About 170 seconds after launch, Super Heavy will return to Earth, and it's going to do a soft landing in the ocean about 30 kilometers away from the launch facility at Boca Chica. Starship will fly to orbit. It's going to spend about 90 minutes flight, and then it's going to return off the coast of Hawaii and try to do a soft landing as well. And so the hope is that both parts will be able to do a soft enough landing to prove that this is truly a fully reusable two-stage rocket. The next test is going to be a hot fire test for the Super Heavy booster. And so when we see that, we'll know we're getting closer. Now, we don't know when it's going to launch, but it sounds soon. Sometime in July, sometime in August. So we could be just around the corner now. And again, this is just a shorter version of the much longer newsletter that I write every week. It goes out to over 50,000 people. There's no ads in it. It's totally free. I write every word, and you can subscribe. Go to universetoday.com/newsletter. And if you want to get an audio edition of everything we do at Universe Today, you should subscribe to our podcast. You can go to universetoday.com/podcast, or just search for Universe Today on iTunes, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. And I put additional audio material into the feed, including interviews with me, behind the scenes. I think you'll really enjoy it. Thank you to everyone who already supports us on Patreon. And a special thanks to all the interplanetary researchers, the interstellar adventurers, and the galaxy wanderers. Your support means the universe to us. All right, those were all the stories that we had this week. Next week's going to be big. We're going to get those first pictures from James Webb. We'll see you then.